Boom. What's up, everyone? Welcome to Simulation. I'm your host, Alan Sakyan. We are still on site. We are now in Brooklyn, in New York. We are very excited to be talking about all things worldviews. We're going to be talking about math. We're going to talk about philosophy. We got a lot to cover in this episode. I'm really excited to be talking to Adam Cato. Hello.
Hey, how's it going?
Thanks for coming on to the show.
Thanks for having me.
I'm really excited for this. We've had some powerful conversation in the last little bit of time getting to know each other. Shout out to Alex K. Chen for introducing us. Yeah, shout out. So Adam's background, Adam's currently at Stony Brook, and he's double majoring in math and philosophy. And he is also an undergraduate researcher there. He's a TA, and he's also doing a second thesis on worldview formalisms. So we've been talking a lot about this, and there is this really sort of gorgeous way of thinking about the way that one's mind absorbs stimuli over time and gains a perspective of a worldview. And this is, again, this is very different for someone that was born 10,000 years ago versus someone that's born 200 years ago or someone that's born today. Mm-hmm. And so they've absorbed different stimuli. They've made a different worldview then. And so now we're even trying to go as far as to literally say that, no, your worldview will never disappear. We'll capture your worldview, your brain.
Oh, yeah. It just evolves.
Through your neurons and your synapses and your memories that you've stored there. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So what? So, yeah.
That's a crazy, it's a very futuristic, almost like far out there kind of thing. But this is, I think, one of the directions in which we're heading.
Yeah, so tell us about your obsessions with this idea of worldviews.
Right, so I think in some sense I've always been obsessed with the concept of a worldview. Just like, you know, not so much like people watching, but like just observing like, oh, like why do people act the way they do? Why do they believe the things that they do? You know, children do this all the time, of course. That's how they, it's a big part of how they learn about the world. You know, adults do it as well. You know, everyone does this all the time, whether or not they like notice it or not. Worldviews are very interesting, structures, I guess. Like not only are they interesting like in themselves, like how, you know, they can be represented or like reasoned about, but, like even like how we come to update our worldviews or like the information that we intake and how we like use that information to update our worldviews. Really interesting stuff. So I should probably, I guess, talk a little bit about like how that happens or like a historical like perspective.
Yeah, definitely.
So the question, I guess, is like, what is a worldview anyway? Now, you ask anyone, they'll give you a different answer. I personally have been particularly influenced by like, as a, you know, philosophy major, a student of philosophy, I guess, like I have been particularly influenced by the like philosophical developmental like process, which like, you know, generates worldviews. So like just looking throughout the history of philosophy, you know, we can kind of depict these like philosophical systems that these philosophers have built throughout time as like their own sorts of worldviews. So you look way back, even just in the Western tradition of philosophy, like back to ancient Greece, you know, these like system builders like Aristotle, Plato, so on and so forth. Like, and you look throughout the modern period, Spinoza, Descartes, Hume, etc. They've all basically been developing worldviews, or like explicit accounts of worldviews. Everyone has a worldview that they work off of. So that kind of brings us to the question, like, what exactly is a worldview? Now, there's a philosopher at the Free University of Brussels who I think has written probably the best account, compressed account of what a worldview is, like a normative account of a worldview. So Clement Vidal at Free University of Brussels wrote this 2012 paper called Metaphilosophical Criteria for Worldview Comparison, where he lists a procedure for like how we go about like updating our worldviews and like our philosophical systems and like criteria that go into you know, like what makes a worldview good or bad or that sort of thing. This is a very like systematic like philosophical account of what a worldview is, and this is, I think, a good normative account, but it also doesn't exactly like address the nuances of like people's worldviews and like determining how exactly you know, the mechanisms that people use to update their worldviews based on like information that they encounter, people that they encounter, artifacts that they encounter. That's a big one, which I guess we'll probably end up touching on later.
But so it's interesting. There's this trajectory of stimuli that you absorb through your life that makes this worldview. But then there's also the way you said that you update your worldview.
Right.
Yeah, that's interesting. The more open-minded you are to maybe saying that, hey, I'm taking in new information, I'm going to update my worldview versus staying closed-minded. That, things like this.
And one of the real, one of the real kickers here is that we, you know, I guess you could say that some people are more open-minded than others about like explicitly updating their worldviews or like updating just their beliefs in general about like, you know, like, or listening to people in arguments and trying to like critically think about the arguments and like, you know, maybe, oh, you know, my position in this argument is not, you know, the best. But, and there are of course people who are more close-minded to that. But what's interesting is that we all take in this, like, this information kind of subconsciously or like latently where, you know, we don't even realize that our worldviews are being updated. Like, this is why charismatic people are so like you, if you interact with a charismatic person, you sort of, or like some say, some could say charismatic or manipulative or whatever. Like there's certain like behavioral phenomena that, you know, you can, that people use to like get you to update your beliefs in some way. So like that's an interesting side note is that like, yeah, you could be explicit about saying, oh, I'm going to say, well, maybe my political beliefs or whatever are, you know, I want to see if they're actually most accurate for, you know, my, what I want, or like if I'm being as ethical as possible and exploring like different ethical theories or considerations or virtues or whatever. So you could be explicit about that, but also there are people who can like subtly like permeate your worldview saying like, oh, maybe you should like egging you on or something like that, which is really interesting. So back to what I was saying about the paper that was written outlining like a normative account of what a worldview is. These are very philosophical in nature and sort of like, I wouldn't say like totally detached from like human subjectivity or like human like behavior or cognition, because they are like the three like clusters, I guess, of like criteria for worldviews are the objective, subjective, and intersubjective accounts, which are like basically like whether or not it's scientific, whether or not it agrees with your like personal motivations and experiences, and whether or not it fits with like an overarching like social narrative, or like a paradigm sort of thing. It's interesting to see how these normative accounts of worldviews that people write or like philosophical accounts, they're not all that there is. There's a lot of latency that people don't see with their worldviews. And like, that's something that I'm trying to capture as well with like my work on worldview studies, worldview formalisms.
Yeah.
That like not just the explicit, like super formal philosophical ways of like developing like philosophical systems, but also capturing like the very minute like day-to-day like little things here and there.
And we'll get to some of that. I mean, yeah, even the way that you carry yourself every day has a tremendous wake in a butterfly effect across the world, smiling as you walk, cascades and impacts people, the way that you engage with other artifacts around you, which we'll get to in a bit. You leave a worldview imprint in your own in your own mind, as well as you popularize things for other people to add to their worldview, depending on what you're disseminating yourself. You started talking about, you know, objective, subjective, and then
intersubjective.
Yeah. So objective seems to be the one that society can agree upon, things like the molecular composition of water or gravity.
Yeah, sort of like that. Independent of like personal or social experiences.
Yeah.
So like that's the, so there are in total like 9 criteria that go into this, or that have been outlined at least in this one paper. And they're split into like 3 categories. So 3 categories of 3 different like criteria, 3 different like sorts of criteria. So in the objective sense, you have like objective consistency, which is like, oh, does it fit with like sort of like almost attached experience or like investigative experience of like not even experience, but like objective fact, so to speak. Is it like internally consistent? Is it consistent with like scientific discoveries, like or like body of scientific knowledge that we've agreed upon, like that we've derived, like not derived, but come to using the scientific method?
Yeah.
You know, there's you have, yeah. That's mostly what the objective, the two of the three criteria for like objective criteria. The third one is scope. So like, does your worldview like address issues, you know, broad in scope or across like universal objective like properties? But also there's the subjective accounts of worldview. So scientism, for instance. So we can come up with like three. Let's come up with like three different examples. So we have a scientism worldview, which is like addressing explicitly like the objective criteria for worldviews. But we also have the subjective accounts, right? This is where I think like religious worldviews are really popular and where they like are most effective. Mm-hmm. And then intersubjective worldviews are I guess religious worldviews also like mm-hmm. address these, and other sorts of secular worldviews, like secular ethical theories, for instance, like if you look at effective altruism. So the intersubjective criteria are like, does it fit with like a social narrative? Is it like, can you? Is there like a social utility for it, right? Like, does it improve social harmony, social well-being, that sort of thing? So this is where I guess something like effective altruism is like a really interesting like movement and an interesting case for like intersubjective criteria for worldviews, because it really does address this sort of like social harmony, social like well-being sort of thing.
Yeah, okay, so now we're starting to do a little breakdown of how we can look at worldviews through objective, subjective, intersubjective. There's also a way of understanding things with the dissemination of memes that I think is really important.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So it's almost as though the more that we take in memes getting disseminated, especially through the information technology infrastructures like the internet now, it's so important for them to be as close, in my opinion, to objectively true as possible. Mm-hmm. Because we can get lost in what is not true. Mm-hmm. And that can deter us away from a cohesive civilization at a time of exponential technology where it's most pressing to have cohesion and truth. Yeah. So yeah, memetics are really important here.
Yeah, absolutely. So memetics are, yeah, they're very important in like worldview studies, because that's basically how, you know, your worldviews are updated, right? So worldview updating is like, in my opinion, like probably the biggest, it's hard to determine what exactly is the most important like part of this field, because of course, like being able to represent it effectively.
And worldview updating would happen from the time you're born.
Oh yeah.
Even through the time you're about to die. Mm-hmm. So worldview updating can be this extremely early education for a child, mm-hmm. all the way to when you're an adult in mm-hmm. conversation, someone gives you some facts, mm-hmm. you go and fact check it, you see it, you mm-hmm. update your worldview.
Yeah. Well, this is also why it's a good example for like describing why like local, like pocket, like political pockets stay the same, or mostly the same, or you know, are more resistant to change, right? Because you know, just take like imagine you're born in a very like let's say liberal town, right? All your friends are liberal, your family's liberal, and you know you basically adopt these. You hear people talking about, oh, like this candidate is good for these reasons, and because we care about these XYZ and certain praxis, right? And you know, that sort of thing. So it's, you know, probably more likely that you'll adopt them earlier on in your life, and especially when you're, you know, more plastic. But now let's say you grow up in a totally conservative town, and people are, you know, doing the same sort of thing, right? It's more likely that you as a person will adopt these conservative beliefs, right? So this is a particularly like telling example, of like a certain type of a certain sort of belief, which is like a political sort of belief or system of beliefs, I should say, that are, you know, formed in like based on like the peers that you interact with and the information that you interact with, depending on like the news networks that maybe your family watches, that sort of thing. Now, updating, right? Let's say now
we can really tunnel down into like a silo.
Yes.
And not really take in other information sources. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Those are our blind spots that we get. And like to update our worldview with those new patches of information is so important to have a well-rounded.
Yeah. And that's a good reason it's why the internet is so important as well, because now you're not your information network is not just limited to the people that you talk to and like large news networks or local news networks, right? You can go anywhere and see what anyone's writing. Like this is, you know, communication, like mass communication is like at our fingertips now. Yeah. And that's really important for worldview updating as well, because you're exposed to so much content that you otherwise wouldn't have been like, maybe like 25 years ago or something.
That's right,
And especially like in the, within the past decade with the explosion of like social media.
Yeah, with the click of a button, you can now update millions of people without needing to even go through a network yourself, like a incumbent newspaper or television network. Even in prior to that, the most you could have is your social circle. Yeah. Your community could maybe know after a couple of days of some accomplishment. And that's it. Yeah.
Those are just people, like if you grow up in, let's say, in like a suburban town, those are just people in your town, right, that you're friends with. Now you can grow up in the same environment, but have people across the country, across the world.
Maybe we're doing too much worldview updating, as it's as though we're not worldview updating with a high level of efficacy towards truth. We're now just looking through too much noise.
Yeah, like social signaling sort of thing.
Social signaling and noise in general. It's not necessarily that because there's so much more information that that means that there's so much more signal, that there's so much more worldview updating towards truth. There may even be worldview updating towards fake news and and deep fakes and everything we got going on now in the near future. Do you find that to be a little bit concerning as you go through like worldview updating in the positive lens towards truth and towards an objective societal push towards cohesion? But then there's also this like false worldview updating.
Right. So the issue with that is that the, I don't know if I'd call it exactly false worldview updating, but
because it the is sort of, worldview
the sort of
updating.
Like quick jumping towards like updating, right? That can be an issue because it's so. You can do it so instantly without. You don't have to like take the time to like think critically on it.
Think critically. Look at more sources. So, that kind
yeah,
of
yeah,
stuff.
That's yeah, yeah. Sort of, it's okay, it's okay. Very like immediate. And you can. Yeah. So you.
I just like to objectively rank that as worse, because if you're not critically thinking and you're not looking at all those additional sources, you can just be manipulated by one item of a video or an article or whatever.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So that's a big issue.
Yeah. Continue.
Right. So, in terms of like, like fake news is a big issue, and I think it's all these reasons are why it's so important to have like a systematic account of like your own worldview and how it changes, and like being able to even like visualize like
your
how like the information that you encounter and like being able to like pair that with like how your behavior changes or like how your like communicative style changes, all these things. Like there's so much like behavioral data that and like communicative data that you can like, you know, pair, I guess, like that is available. You just have to be clever. And,
So the idea is that it's fascinating if we gain enough of a metacognitive perspective on our own lives to say, to look in a mirror at ourselves and the stimuli we've taken in order to be who we are, to have the worldview that we do, and then. And then we have to really honestly look at ourselves, because then we can realize that maybe I'm not critically thinking enough. Maybe I'm not looking at extra information patches that I should be in order to update more my worldview a little bit more holistically.
And that's why, people also have to be incentivized to do this. Ooh. So they can be internally incentivized to do it just by like being truth seeking, for instance. They could be incentivized by like externally, just like either by like social pressures, like peer pressures, or like school pressures or something like that. Like, let's say they have a project where they have to do this and they have to get a good grade on it, that sort of thing. There are some like, there's some issues there, like with like incentive alignment, because a lot of times people wouldn't be so like incentivized to like think critically, and really reflect on whether or not they're doing it correctly. Yeah. And this is where, I didn't touch on all nine of those points.
Totally.
That it would take hours for each of them.
I know.
But like, this is why. I think it was like the fifth point that was outlined or something, which is like personal utility. Mm. This is why that's so important for worldviews, is because if you want to actually do something like praxeologically, or like to actually like take action in like making the world a better place, and like getting people to be like more like reflective and like, that's a bit like, you have to get them to do it. You have to make it, you have to give some sort of like utility, or like some, so basically it's just some reason why people should want to do this sort of thing. So people already have like peer pressures, or like truth-seeking pressures, or like their own internal pressures or external pressures to do this sort of thing. But it's not super commonplace.
Yeah, we have to really incentivize this to help us progress faster.
Yeah, yeah, and that's why this sort of like comprehensive worldview study is important.
Yeah,
because like, if you're just focusing on like the objective parts, right? Sure, like I agree that's very, very important to do. Like, it's like modeling the world as it is, right? But you also have to determine exactly how to get people to want to do this sort of thing, right? There's like, because you know, we are socially embedded. There's a lot of like stuff flying around in the social sphere that are drawing people away from like being.
That's right. From the distractions are rampant right now.
Yeah.
If you want to actualize your fullest potential into the world, you have to become really good at looking at yourself in the mirror and calling yourself out for when you're too much in an echo chamber, your worldview's not being updated properly enough. Now, Adam, I think this is important to address, and we talked about this when we were chatting earlier, the idea of a potentially a best worldview. The idea that there, that I know this is tough for a philosopher. This is really, it's tough. It's but at the same time, this is really important for early childhood education. Is that if we say that, okay, a child's born into the world, there should be just some fundamentals that we embed into the neurology of a child at a young age, into their mind, and we potentially say things like, okay, well, you should understand that we were birthed from the cosmos, and you should understand that the Earth revolves around the star, and that the star gives us the power to have a civilization, and that you have this heart inside of you and this brain inside of you. The heart beats 100,000 times a day, the brain, and gives you the information processing for everything that you have in storage for the rest of your life. And maximize your time here, find what you care about, and bring value to the world. I think that if we have some sort of a bare fundamental truth that we can build worldviews upon, like we've been doing, like, okay, we learned agriculture, we're here, we learned some scientific method principles, we're here now, that if we keep building on that, and if more people gravitate towards that and potentially away from the echo chambers where there's potentially people coming in with propaganda to try and lure their eyeballs and attention into things that are fake news, that aren't actual, that are actual false for the greed and pockets of other people. So what do you think about an ideal truth-seeking worldview?
It's definitely a hot topic of debate amongst pretty much anyone. That's a tall drink of water, but like, it depends. So like, some people would view it, various people would view it in different ways. So you'd say, you'd have like postmodernists, right? Who, the meme that's spread is like, oh, you know, postmodernists say there's no such thing as like objective truth. Everything is subjective, that sort of thing. Which is a yeah, like, that's one, like, view of it. Then you have other, you know, other philosophers or academics or anyone, really, who will say, oh, no, there's, like, some objective truth out there, some objective truth in, or, like, maybe, like, even localized objective truths, like, within, like, aesthetics or, like, ontology, metaphysics, epistemology, so on and so forth. So, like, is there such a thing as objective beauty? Is there such a thing as, like, objective, like, structure of reality, like, that we could maybe, like, formalize mathematically in some way? Is, you know, there is some objective, like, nature to, like, mathematics also, mm-hmm. anything like that, right? So it very well could be the case that these are, there are objective truths in these, like, localized senses. You know, like, it's a very difficult question. But, you know, maybe there could be, like, objective beauty versus maybe not, like, objective, like, nature of mathematics. Is mathematics cognitive? Is it, like, Platonistic in, like, the abstract, detached sense of mathematics? Like, there's a lot of different, like, sub-questions that this question is begging, I think. So whether or not there is one explicit, like, one true worldview is also a very open-ended question. I think if we frame it in the sense of, like, is there one worldview that under some, like, some normative account of worldviews is the best worldview, that is a different question, and I think that has an answer.
Oh, okay, cool. Let's answer that question.
Right. So you could say, well, you know, we want our worldview to be as scientifically valid as possible. We want our worldview to be as, you know, emotionally, you know, drawing in as possible, that sort of thing. And so you could say, well, maybe we have some, like, optimization function or something, where we want to optimize, like, some certain metric, which is already problematic. But maybe there's, like, something that we want to optimize for, some interplay between the different criteria that go into worldviews or philosophical systems or anything like that, right?
Okay, optimize flourishing. What is flourishing? Okay,
so Aristotle raising, will tell you something differently than Will McCaskill.
Yeah, raising the baseline of living for all beings. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
And then now so you break that down.
There's a lot of metaethical concerns here, like, oh, which normative theory do we pick? Is there, like, some static normative theory that we pick, or are we constantly in this dialectical process of updating our ethical
theories? We are. That's right. We are.
I tend to think so as well.
Okay. So what is really left to argue about? Is left to argue about? If humanity engages in a continuous dialogue about updating our worldview over time and continuously updating what we believe is the best logical structure, the function for raising a child's mind into the world, mm-hmm. what is there to argue about after that?
Anything that's localized within the dialogue. And also,
sure, but then, like, that just gets sorted out.
Of the dialogue itself.
Sure.
How
does it take place?
Best have, like, the, like, there's, like, rhetoric, argumentation, logic, all this sort of stuff that you have to reflect on the, like dialectical process or the dialogical process.
Yeah.
And, you know, you have to think, oh, what is this dialogue for? Like, for what purposes are we having this dialogue? Some people will say, oh, to get, like, at objective truth. Some people will say, oh, well, to get at, you know, to maximize human flourishing or human well-being, or, like, human valence or something, like, according to whatever, like, theory they subscribe to. So, like, Aristotle will tell you something different than, like, ineffective altruists, or, like, someone who subscribes to valence realism versus, like, virtue ethics or something like that, right? So
I feel like we can get, we talked about this a little bit too, is that we can get so lost in just the incessant drive to be like, oh, well, this is just such a little bit different than this is. And because if we get so lost in that, then we we gotta drive towards some unity code that drives us towards that flourishing and then constantly have dialogue about how to update that unity code.
Well, yeah, this is why I think worldviews are such a good, like, all-encompassing tool for this. Is that, you know, we can do, like, we have certain values, right? We can subscribe to different value systems or theories of value, right? So one of them could be, like, utilitarianism, where we say we value, so, like, the greatest good for the greatest number of people, And if you're really like into it, you can say, oh, well, we can give you some like metrics and some like ontological restrictions, saying like, oh yeah, like this is how exactly we measure well-being. So we should calculate what we ought to do in order to like maximize that sort of well-being on those metrics. Other people will say, oh, you should just subscribe to these virtues. So let's throw the utilitarian framework completely out of the window and say, oh, well, subscribe to this system of virtues. And another virtue ethicist would say something similar, but like give it a different system of virtues. And then you have contractualists and deontologists and so on and so forth, right? We'll tell you something completely different. And so we can actually like systematically track this using not only systematically track like our like ethical considerations, but like how they relate to our ontological considerations and our like you know, systems of action and political beliefs and so on and so forth. So like there are like a lot of considerations here, and I think worldviews are like good systematic tools for like tracking you know, how we ought to like even using the word ought is like a presupposition, but like how we, you know, in what ways we do already like, you know, reason about the world, model the world, that sort of thing. And you said you said something that I think I forgot. Like you said, like, why should we care about like the like what is there left to argue? I think. And I think you said something after that.
Maybe not so much like there will always be things left to argue.
Mm-hmm. But we're going like too far into one like pocket or one corner, I think you said.
Yeah,
like
and
that.
We're getting potentially too caught up in, like, in
irrelevant things.
There's got to be some sort of a basic level, mm-hmm, of like, we all agree that we came from the cosmos. Mm-hmm. We all agree your heart beats 100,000 times a day. Mm-hmm. We all agree that you're going to get about 25,000 days to, mm-hmm, live, and that the stimuli that you put in your mind are really important for where you end up going, mm-hmm, in the world, the formulation of your worldview. Mm-hmm. So I think if we can agree on these fundamentals that we're all children of evolution of the cosmos, mm-hmm, and we're all one tribe as the planet, and we write these things into our code, mm-hmm, and then we write into the code that we're going to, mm-hmm, maximize resource flows to raise that baseline, mm-hmm, and we got to figure out how to maximize the flows and how to raise the baseline. This is through, mm-hmm, dialogue we get there. But those are the things left to talk about. But I mean, how do we update the minds of the people that disagree that we came from the cosmos? Mm-hmm. How do we update the minds of the people that say my heart does not beat 100,000 times, mm-hmm, a day, you know?
Yeah, that's a very big issue as well. It's a big, even like political issue. But
I think I have a question for you.
Yeah.
My question is for you: how do you update your worldview?
Mm-hmm. So it's a good question. So I update my worldview basically by having, I don't exactly have a static worldview that I keep at all times, and then say, oh, here's how I like. Based on this new information, here's new considerations that I take into it, and this like formal system sort of thing. I don't exactly have that, like explicitly mapped out, but I do have this sort of like rough picture of like, oh, here's a normative account of what a worldview is, and here's how like I can represent my beliefs and like personal history and so on and so forth with this like worldview tool, basically like almost like a modeling tool. So I say, okay, well, here's how like all the different parts interact, right? You know, whether I have certain ontological beliefs or like epistemological beliefs or whatever I consider to be like first philosophy, or like most the like philosophical area that takes most precedence, that sort of thing, and like what reasoning tools I use, so on and so forth. So I have like a rough model of that, and I say, okay, well, based on this new information that I run into or these new arguments that I get into. You know, where did I go wrong? And where are the weak points in my beliefs? And should I alter those or just like think more critically on them? Because maybe they're right, that sort of thing. So argumentation is a good way to update your beliefs. And I also use, the online rationalist community uses the term updating to mean something sort of different, in some sense. But I don't mean it in the strict like Bayesian sort of context, in like the context of like formal like belief or vision. It's more like a rough picture. But anyway, like yeah, like you that's basically what I do. It's argumentation. I read a whole bunch of different, you know, like philosophy, mathematics, you know, neuroscience, psychology, sociology, so on and so forth, politics, like political theory.
That's how you do it.
Yeah. So in one sense, like that's more towards like the objective accounts usually. So the objective criteria, but also like, you know, updating your like moral beliefs is not as simple. Like, you know, there is some like human emotionality aspect to it. Whether or not this like is what ought to be like the normative case, that's up for debate. Like you could say, oh, well, some people will say, well, based on these like ontological considerations, right? Like about like, you know, like pain, suffering, happiness, joy, so on and so forth. Which you could like, I guess, roughly characterize as valence. So like how much well-being or suffering you have. You know, people say, oh, there are actually ways to like experimentally like determine your valence. And if we take this like this one belief of valence realism, then you know we have like a grounding for the like an ontological grounding for the rest of our system. And if we take ontology as first philosophy, then we have a completely like philosophically grounded system, and like a system of action even, because we have like methods for like determining exactly how to go about like finding out what is, you know, the correct action to take. Not only just what is like the correct process, like you know, for determining what actions to take, but actually like figuring out what those are and doing them in the world.
We may have ramped our population up too fast in the last 100 years. And with that population being ramped up so fast has made it harder for us to update our worldviews more effectively towards that basic unity of truth that we needed. Because now we have so many worldviews that are so all over the place, so far away from truth in so many different ways. And those are 10-year, 30-year, 50 years into their lives, the formulation of those minds, that now it's becoming more and more difficult as the population's increasing. But the ability to create media that can update people's worldviews is something that we care a lot about, and that if we can properly do that and get people to awaken and drool to how gorgeous it is that we are all from Earth, and that there have been 100 billion people that lived and died before us to build all of the infrastructure that we have today, that then maybe there will be a deeper sense of awe and connection to each other, even though our population has skyrocketed so much. You spend a lot of time, I can tell, and in lands of philosophy that are really deep that I haven't scratched the surface of, and that a lot of people haven't scratched the surface of, and that going that deep can be both a tremendous advantage because you can more granularly break things down, but it can also potentially be a disadvantage when we're trying. And the same thing's true about anyone at the edge of their field that understands the granularity of everything in their field, but then the lateral thinking. Your lateral thinking is still really good, Adam, but there's a lot of lateral thinking that needs to still be developed to gain that multidisciplinary, holistic understanding of things. And making things simple, the Occam's razor approach to just going and making it the most, making it the most simple way to disseminate to people that can then get them most easily actualized. I want us to talk about artifacts. This is extremely important. You made me really realize that every time that we say the word water, or we say the word bowl or cup, or car or whatever, we're further baking this artifact into our mind. Every time we make a purchase, that's a digital log of something that we've bought, and then that if we can open up these data silos of the things that we buy and the words that we use, and we can really understand how people have gained the worldview they have and how to best help people update their worldviews.
Right, and that's so that goes back to what you were saying about like lateral thinking and like multidisciplinary, interdisciplinary sort of thinking, is that we have like all these people working in different areas on different like silos, right? And you know, there's not as much like connectivity between them as maybe there should be, right? So like maybe like philosophers would do philosophy differently if they knew more about like biology or neuroscience or like physics or any of like, there's only so much that you can specialize in or like know too much about. But yeah, like opening up these silos and like connecting these silos is very, very important for like getting a more holistic, I mean like there's no other way to get a more holistic world picture than by just like doing it, like connecting, like learning about all these different areas and trying to connect them and build like new sorts of disciplines, right? You know, we see this all the time in like pure math as well, where, you know, mathematicians synthesize different areas of mathematics to create new branches. You said something earlier that I found interesting, but there were a lot of things that you said that were interesting, so I kind of forgot it. But I think it had to do with, I associated with the term global connectivity. So I think you were saying, like, you know, our population has been increasing, you know, so much over the past 100 years. And, you know, not only that, but like, we're becoming more globally connected thanks to the internet, right? You can talk to anyone around the world. People like Dunbar's number is probably increasing in some sense, because like you can, you know, talk to all these different people very quickly and have like periodic reminders and that sort of thing. So of course, like that's only under like one, I guess, like definition of what it means to like communicate with someone or like sufficiently, I guess. But we're becoming so much more globally connected, and we're being exposed to different worldviews that we've never seen before. Different like political theories, I guess, or like social hierarchies and that sort of thing, than we've ever been exposed to before. And so this is why like systematically understanding people who are not like ourselves, who you know, did not grow up in the same conditions, why that's so important, and like how we can figure out how to more effectively come to like, or be like socially harmonious, right? And not only that, but this is also where like, I know social justice gets like a bad rap, but this is where like some sort of like social justice comes into play, where like, you know, there are people across the world, you know, like we are fortunate enough to live in a first world country, right? With like all these like, you know, running water and so on and so forth. Pick your like archetype.
Yeah, social justice about raising the baseline of living for all beings across the world and eradicating the violences that occur in greed and corruption and racism and sexism and bigotry of any sort. Yeah.
Yeah, and I think we also get very caught up in like our own like the basically we've had such a lot of us have had such good educational like opportunities, that sort of thing, where we sort of like, there was a quote from this book, Philosophical Dialectics, an Essay on Metaphilosophy by Nicholas Rescher, where he taught, I don't remember the exact quote verbatim, but it was like, when we ignore like the systemic interconnectedness of philosophical disciplines, philosophy, we can really get like, we can hop on our hobby horses and just like go in one direction, like, without considering the rest, like the actual, like what's important, right? So like sometimes it seems like we're even doing this with like our, like I hesitate to say first world philosophy, but like it seems like we often like discount, you know, people in like underdeveloped countries, which is why like effective altruism is like a good like starting point, I think. There needs to, I guess, be more like infrastructural development or something, but That's a completely different topic of discussion. But
I want to hear how you want to help us understand how we engage with artifacts those update our worldviews.
So we should first just like explicate what exactly an artifact is. So like, you know, artifacts are just like any like sort of like technological gadgets or any like item that has been human made. So like table could be an artifact, whatever, or a computer could be an artifact, the internet in some sense could be considered an artifact. Like it's this like, you know, it's describing the ontology of the internet is, you can do it in several different ways. But like, yeah, the internet is an artifact. It's, you know, it's a man-made construct that, you know, we interact with. We interact with different parts of the internet, of course, but like, yeah, it's shaped our lives so much. Not just like our, you know, like belief systems based on like what we've interacted with on the internet, but even just like, you know, our like neurology, I guess, or the way we like our mm-hmm. cognition, right? There's like general trends of like going more towards like instant gratification, that sort of thing. Yeah. Like thanks to like Twitter and like, you know, video games and so on and so forth. Yeah, like, so you said how can we like use artifact or like, I guess like
understand our engagement
with artifacts,
artifacts and how that updates our worldviews. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right. So it's hard to like systematically track that, right? Because like we don't have enough like obtaining the behavioral data is also very difficult. But I think also with the Internet of Things, it would be easier to track, like even just like what you interact with, not even how you interact with it. Like
when we open up the data flows, it becomes easier to mm-hmm. do this, to see what we're interacting with when it becomes decentralized.
Yeah.
And then we gain better insights. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And the internet, I feel like I also sort of gave like a mischaracterization of the Internet of Things. It's like, you know, it's not exactly like, It's hard to describe exactly, but like one example I could give is like WeChat Pay, right? It's like we have all these different like, you know, so WeChat Pay is like the Venmo for like China, basically, but it's like ubiquitous. Like it's used like you can use it to purchase pretty much anything in like big cities in China, and so like if you can you have like a catalog of like all these different you know, things that you're selling, that kind of thing, and you can say, okay, here's the transaction that I made, mm-hmm. Like I purchased this thing or you know, spent money to do whatever. That would be one way of, you know, determining, oh, here's what I interacted with, in terms of like the artifactual world. Now, like with people, it's sort of similar. Like it's very, very difficult to do this sort of like data science, but yeah, like there's like the like going back, I guess, from the artifacts, like the reason why we're trying to do this is to determine how like our worldviews change, right, based on what we interact with. Yeah. So, you know, of course they change from based on like how we interact with different things around us, and different people around us and different like ideas that are around us. So you could call them like memeplexes, like collections of memes that form that like tend to form together, and how we interact with like those like higher order like complexes of ideas. So like this is a very like fruitful like research area as well.
Yeah.
And yeah,
there's so many artifacts. Mm-hmm. Because everything is an artifact, it becomes really difficult to identify which artifacts we should actually log first as part of making up our worldview, mm-hmm. and then better understand how we're updating our lives with mm-hmm. those artifacts. It seems as though there's so much data in the silos of mm-hmm. the Facebooks and Amazons,
yeah, like
and Googles and Apples of the world, even our banking data, mm-hmm. just to be able to decentralize those and be able to scrape them to find where we're what artifacts we're engaging with, how often we're taking Uber or Lyft rides, how often we mm-hmm. are purchasing food versus purchasing groceries, mm-hmm. And what groceries we are purchasing, what farmers we're supporting. This mm-hmm. goes, again, it's the cybernetics view of things. It's just mm-hmm. all super interconnected.
Yeah, and the whole like causality thing is interesting too. Like you could say, oh, you know, there were these trends in my life where, let's say I did purchase more of this type of food, or this like food at this type of place, like let's say like a fast food place or something.
Yes,
and you know, well, what caused that? Well, there could be like stress, like external stressors, or like travel or something like that.
You could totally start finding relationships and starting
yeah,
to
yeah. Yeah. Like, this is a big research area that Sandy Pentland's lab, at the social physics lab at the MIT Media Lab, yeah. is working on this sort of thing. I'm not sure exactly how much they use like causality related yeah. things, but that would be an interesting thing to look at.
Yeah. Right. All right. How about we go into the benefits of semantic publishing?
Oh yeah. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So this is a bit different from semantic publishing is just like we should first, I guess, look at the history of by semantic publishing I mean like scientific publishing, like publishing scientific results in like a semantic like let's say like markup language or some formal ontology or something. That is machine readable, like natively machine readable, as opposed to like having to like do all this like text mining, on like corpora of text. Now semantic publishing is sort of like I wouldn't say like it's sort of like not disrupting like the publishing industry, but that along those like lines, right? Where for the past several hundred years, I think like 300 years or something, we've had this like journal sort of publishing, or like a paper-based publishing. So you write up a paper, and then you disseminate it. You submit it to a journal, and then if it's good, it gets accepted, and it gets disseminated to all the people who want to read the journal, that sort of thing. And we've seen like a more like open source type of thing with like the archive. And like Plus One, all those like open access journals. Now that's really, really good, especially for like opening those like data silos to like people who otherwise would not be able to afford the journals. But they're still also in this format that is not machine readable, right? Or it's like hard to like get actual like content, get scientific content from those papers, right? So to get actual like semantic like meaning, right? That's very difficult. Now, what semantic publishing does is it says, okay, you can still like submit these papers, but you can also define like these semantic networks of like like high level scientific information or just information about the study that you've done or whatever research you've done, right? So this was developed at the Free University of Amsterdam. By Tobias Kuhn. So he has this like, so they're called nano publications. So there's a series of like different sorts of semantic publications. So there's micro publications is what it's called, is another like form. So it's still like these, like a paper-based sort of publication, but it's like a very short paper with like, also with like semantic data.
So the more machine readable yes. our scientific papers are, the more we can make connections mm-hmm. between them and better understand how to update our worldview faster, more effectively.
Not even so much that, but just like deriving like new like avenues for like scientific exploration, and like also determining like who this person, uploaded this this network of data.
So it'd be
there's like provenance there as well.
You see an array of data being published, and then you realize, well, what about this area or that area or intertwining mm-hmm. these two?
Yeah, yeah.
And so then those are the mm-hmm. those are the black and or those are the gray areas that we haven't explored mm-hmm. yet. And so then we're prompted, go invest mm-hmm. investigate into those areas.
Yeah, and even like for visualization purposes, it's really good too.
Totally, yeah. Okay, how are you going to take your undergraduate research, how are you gonna take the thesis of these worldviews, how are you going to take this and disseminate it as an entrepreneur, an artist, as a professor, how are you going to get this out to more people?
Yeah, so that's the classic like academic issue. It's like, I'm working on this stuff that's really cool, but like oftentimes very few people care about it. If you're, let's say even in like pure math, like highly specialized fields of pure math, like I heard one person say, like, yeah, I dropped out of my PhD after my like fifth or sixth year because after working on it for like all these years, because I realized I wasn't passionate about it or like as passionate as I used to be, and like you know, only four people could understand it outside of myself, yeah, much less care. So that's the classic like academic issue. And same with philosophy, like outside of like typically like pretty narrow
subjects. You want to be translational to hopefully billions of people.
Yeah, that's a big issue. But like, your vision? The way I'm trying to do this, I'm very much impact focused first. I would not do this work if I didn't think it could actually have like positive social impact. There are of course issues with this sort of thing as well, but not just. I don't want to just do meta philosophy or like work on formalizing worldviews, that sort of thing. I'm doing that for the particular reason that I can, you know, actually create applications for people to like explicate their own worldviews, track how their like worldviews are updating, and that sort of thing, and debate with other people.
How would you make those applications for people to better update their worldviews and debate with others? How would you do that?
So this goes back into like determining what exactly is a worldview. So there are certain like representation issues that you have to consider, like how do I actually model these things, and how do I get people how do I incentivize people to actually like write in their own worldviews, right? So one way of starting to do this is saying like, oh, you can just like get it from like polls that people answer, right? Like, oh, like, do you prefer like this political candidate or that political candidate, or do you prefer this in this situation, would you prefer to, you know, in this like ethical minded situation, like the trolley problem, for instance, mm-hmm, would you prefer to do this or that? And you could say, oh, well, you know, different answers that you give on these like survey questions can determine certain things about your worldview.
Sure.
And maybe like, let's say you're given this a political compass or something like that. We say, oh, maybe that's not an accurate description. Let me like investigate this further, that sort of thing. There are, that's only one trajectory. There's a whole bunch of different trajectories that are possible for this sort of thing.
So you're and just gonna keep exploring.
Yeah, and like another thing to consider is like, you could also use it to help philosophers do better philosophy, or like more like interconnected philosophy, where, you know, they say, okay, here's like a philosophical system that I'm working with, that I'm working in, right? Or some theories in some subfields that I subscribe to and advocate for, and maybe there are some people who oppose this, so I'm going to argue with them, and we can come to like either a compromise or like whatever, that sort of thing. Now,
the data silos seem to be a really hot place to go to, because if you can scrape mm-hmm. that data and incentivize people to work together across the silos, mm-hmm. then you can really gain a good mm-hmm. psychometric footprint on what someone's worldview is.
Mm-hmm. And you can also like say like you can suggest like communities for people to join based on like these certain
you know, then you can pass them that as the next step.
And there are also a lot of ethical concerns here.
You may be
there's like privacy concerns.
Sure, sure.
And like manipulation.
Well, if it's all encrypted and decentralized, anonymized, then maybe it's a little bit easier to do. But also, you do want to be a little nudged out of an echo chamber, mm-hmm. and you know, you can get that if someone's making a recommendation for you based on your purchase history and your chat history and stuff mm-hmm. like that. I want to ask you a couple quick questions that we typically ask mm-hmm. on the way out. And of course, we've only scratched the surface on worldview understandings mm-hmm. and updatings and period. This is a very mm-hmm. interesting subfield, and we'll hopefully be able to dive into this in more depth over time.
Yeah.
The typical questions, I think it was good though, it was a good first conversational mm-hmm. start to things. First question, what's a core driving principle of yours?
Oh man, it depends on the day, I guess. But I'd say most of the time it's social harmony. The reason why I'm doing this is like it's a communications project, pretty much. I wouldn't even characterize it as like a philosophy project. It's a communications project for people to more effectively like collaborate with each other and cooperate with each other and just understand each other. So that also can get us closer to the truth, right?
Yeah.
If we're, you know, we're not so caught up in like these like bickerings and that sort of thing. So yeah, probably I'd say social harmony. It's a very like complicated answer that I wouldn't have enough time to go into here, because the way I got to that, to this, you know, this like conclusion, I guess, or this like core driving principle, is like very strange and like convoluted, and like a better explication of social harmony in the way that I see it is like also like a bit like convoluted. But yeah, basically just getting like increasing like I guess like global connectivity and like
that sort of thing. That's a good answer, social harmony. The communication infrastructure and design that we have today mm-hmm. will directly produce the world we live in tomorrow. So mm-hmm. it's a good answer. What about, next question, if you could rebuild civilization mm-hmm. from scratch, how would you design it?
Oh yeah, so I got a similar question at like an icebreaker thing, or an icebreaker session at a conference that I went to about like 6-7 months ago. I didn't really have a good answer then. I'm still not sure if I have a good answer, but if I could design civilization from scratch, like human civilization, you mean? Is there like a starting point that I'm going towards, or how would I design it? I don't know exactly how I would design it, but I would probably just get people to be more cooperative with, or like I don't know. That's a very loaded question. But yeah, I don't know if I'm supposed to be designing, there's so many different like factors here. Like, am I supposed to be designing like the biology of humans, or like communicative structures or something? Like it
pick,
very much
pick.
Yeah. So like if I were to like, let's say like program my own like world, mm-hmm. Where, you know, we don't have like the several billion or how mm-hmm. like mm-hmm. 14.7 billion years of cosmic like evolution, and then like, you know, biological evolution, so on and so forth. Yeah, that's a really cool question. There's like population concerns as well. I definitely change how receptive people are to like, you know, people whose, I guess, worldviews oppose their own, and just pretty much make people more open to like new information, new experiences, that sort of thing. My comprehensive answer would take much more time to explain, but
yeah, this is good. It's thought experiment wise. I'm mm-hmm. glad that you also ran in a bunch of different ways, which is very important. Mm-hmm. Next question. Do you think we're in a simulation?
I definitely did it at one point. In fact, that was the grounding for my entire worldview for several months. And that's a long story as well. But
when you were in that worldview, mm-hmm. tell us about what it was like.
Mm. So I sort of like latched on. So I had these like ontological beliefs, I guess, or like arguments. I wouldn't say ontological arguments, because that typically has a connotation or like a reference to like certain like philosophical arguments throughout history, like by Aquinas and Gödel and like other people. These like arguments basically like they were started based on Zeno's paradoxes of motion. And so I got to thinking like, oh, maybe space-time is discrete, because I think I can better refute the arguments against like continuous space-time than I can against discrete space-time. And like I have all these like computational tools that I've been exposed to, that sort of thing. And like, oh yeah, like, okay. And of course, like growing up with the internet and like computers, I was probably more biased towards that view as well. And then like things such as like the simulation argument, like Bostrom's simulation argument, and like stuff that Max Tegmark has written, those sorts of things, definitely like pushed me further towards that. And so you said I am on my second undergrad thesis. My first undergrad thesis was actually on, it was motivated by this simulation aspect, where it was actually giving like computational formalisms for you know, the base like ontological structure of the world, and how we can basically abstract from certain like computational models to, you know, give a natural like account of that's sort of, like this simulatory sort of thing.
Because when you do go back and compute what happens with this this code in this universe, and you fast forward 13.8 billion years, you see us here having this conversation. All right, last question. What do you think is the most beautiful thing in the world?
Oh, yeah, okay. I don't know if it's like, I think math, honestly. That's my honest answer, is math. Like there's, it's so nicely compressed, and like I think the strongest like emotional reactions that I've had to things in my life was actually to like mathematical results that I've seen.
I love it.
Yeah, so probably that. Like, I don't think there's like, I don't subscribe to objective beauty, but in for me personally, in my own subjective experience,
it's
probably
math.
Yeah.
I love it. I love it, Adam.
Most generally, like in most cases.
Yeah. This has been such a good episode across worldviews, across understanding how to best update them, across understanding how to best parse all of the information, finding signal, updating our worldviews through that, helping understand how to best guide children through their stimuli and their worldviews. And there's a lot to unpack left, but I like the path towards a civilizational truth and building on top of that and having dialogue to build on that.
Towards social harmony.
Towards social harmony, yeah. Adam, thanks for coming on to the show.
Thanks for having me. Yeah. This is great.
Yeah, this has been such a super pleasure. Thanks everyone for tuning in. We greatly appreciate it. We would love to hear from you. Let us know your thoughts in the comments below on the topics we were talking about. Do join us in the conversation. Also, do check out Adam's links below in the bio. Check out his links. And join us. Join Simulation. We need your help to continue sustaining the project, growing it, coming to more great places like New York to interview diverse leaders. So do join us. And go and build the future, everyone. Manifest your destiny into the world. We got 25,000 days each. Let's build the future. We love you very much, and we'll see you soon. Peace. That's it.
Cool.
Good job. Awesome. Good job.